To introduce Pradeep Chakravarti, who will be presenting an illustrated talk on metalware of Tamil Nadu. A graduate from the London School of Economics and Jawaharlal Nehru University, Pradeep has had a distinguished corporate career of more than two decades. His scholarly interests lie in his study of ancient Tamil history, heritage, art, and literature. In pursuit of which he has published five books and over 300 essays in reputed publications. With the support of mythologist and author Devdutt Patnaik, he has created a series of self-awareness sessions and tours based on Indian philosophy, mythology, and history. In addition, he curated the Saraswati Mahal Library exhibition that was presented at IIC in 2015. While there's much more to add, I now hand over to Pradeep and the metalware of Tamil Nadu. Pradeep, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Ritu. Without much further ado, let me share my screen and we should start. Thank you very much for this opportunity. I got interested in the metalware of Tamil Nadu ever since I was a child. I had the unique opportunity of spending my summer vacations in a 10,000 square feet home that had belonged to our family for more than six generations. And the upstairs of that family home was filled with a lot of metalware, vessels mostly, but other things as well. And I grew up appreciating these, and I think that spurred the interest in me doing much deeper research on this. So in this company school drawing over here, we have two images of metal workers, and we're going to look at the beautiful things that they have created in the past. Agnir Debod Vijitinam. Muninam Hrida Tarshinam Swalpa Buddhinam is the way this verse goes. And what it basically says is that the Brahmins see the God in fire. And for all ascetics and monks, they see God within their hearts. Those with a little insight see it in a statue, but those with true equanimity, they see God everywhere. And I think in every object that I will show you today, truly, the craftspeople have seen divinity in the metal that they have fashioned and in the motifs that they have created and the way they have created it, and which is probably why in all the images that I'm going to show today, none of them do we know who the artist was. And I think the artist was so involved in creating an object of beauty that he thought it was an end in itself and didn't really bother to sign his name, as is usually in many of the other traditions. So the history of forging metal in Tamil Nadu is a very ancient one. And there are, when we talk about metal objects, they are of two types. One is the ghana, which is the solid metal work. And the other is the sushira, which is the sheet metal work. So the ghana metal work is how a chola bronze would be created, for example. It's called the lost wax process. And the sushira, a sheet of metal is beaten into a particular shape. And we'll find examples of both of these from the ancient
time. Sorry for the interruption, sir. Sorry for the interruption. You are not sharing your presentation, sir, actually. You are just open your presentation. I'm not sharing. Okay. I'll request you to share your presentation. Thank you.
Sorry about that. Is it okay now? Is it okay now, Vaseem?
Yes, sir.
Yes, it started now.
Thank you. Good. So this was the slide I was in. We've not missed anything before. So the ghana bronzes are, the ghana ware is made out of the lost wax process, and the sushira is made in a way that the metal sheet is hammered into the shape that the artist wants. Very, very much deep down in Tamil Nadu, on the banks of the Tamrapani River, close to a town called Tirunelveli, is a tiny speck that you'll find it literally impossible to find on the map. This is the village of Adichinallur, which is on the Tamrapani River bank. And on the banks of the river in that site are pits like this, and this is how the landscape is. And over here, about more than 100 years back, they discovered these. This image, which is under the caption of Ghana, is South India's oldest bronze figure. It's of the mother goddess. experts date it to anything between 2000 to 3000 BC. Some people are pushing it for even further. And on the other side is the Sushira image of a golden head ornament, which was worn on the forehead of the funerary remains that we found in Adichananur. Fortunately, the bronze is still with us and it's in the government museum in Chennai. And for those of you who intend to come to Chennai or live in Chennai, I would strongly recommend that you go and see the collection there of the Adichananur excavation, because not only do we have this rare bronze image, which is really tiny, it's just about 3 inches or 4 inches, but we have many, many iron implements and other and pottery vessels as well. Most of the gold jewelry that was found over there about 120 years back are actually in the Berlin Museum now. So the reason that I'm showing you this is the tradition of having Gana and Sushira is not a medieval or a later period invention. It's been there from 2 to 3000 BC as itself. And then, of course, much later, all the Chola bronzes that were quite infamous some time back and are famous otherwise are all from the Gana tradition. And we have beautiful vessels like this, which are typically made out of the Sushira tradition. And we'll come back to understanding all of this later. So when we have to admire an object of beauty, the Indian qualification for what is beautiful is quite different from what is beautiful in the West. The Vastu Shastra today has been largely hijacked by astrologers, but much, if not most, of the Vastu Shastra is actually a treatise in craftsmanship and in civil engineering. And in the Vastu Shastra is a shloka which looks at what is an object, what are the parameters for an object to be judged beautiful, and you'll find this reflected in all the objects that I'm going to show you today. The first is Bhogadhyam, which is that the object should be made in a way that it fully utilizes the purpose for which it is made. So usability is the first objective. So let's take this humble water pot, for example. We don't even need to go to all the expensive Chola bronzes. The neck is narrow to prevent the water from splashing out. The middle is fairly wide to ensure that the maximum volume of water is stored. This is Bhogadhyam. Sugadarshana is something that is pleasing to the eye. And in a river valley civilization, which is largely, which is community-based, Sukadarshana is about blending in with others, which is why all our epics and our stories are about to quell the eye or the ahankara in us. And the way to quell the ahankara in us is to be like the other people, which is why similarity is very important. And Sukadarshana is about symmetry and similarity to things around us. So Sukadarshana would be in terms of the water pot being symmetrical in nature and the designs over here being symmetrical and being of a particular, of a very repeated pattern as well. So it blends in with the remaining patterns on the water pot. The third criteria is Ramya, which is inner delight. Inner delight is the ability to keep looking at even the most humble work of art when we look at it on a day-to-day basis again and again and again. The hope is that once we look at it very deeply, we say, what could this motive mean to me in my own life? What could the way this object created, what could it be, what could it mean to my own life? What kind of a life's lesson can I learn from it? So for example, from textile, for example, the warp can be of a different color, the weft can be of a different color, and the wearer, as they keep wearing it, would also start recognizing how people are different and yet similar, and how we need to work with these differences to be able to succeed, just as the sari becomes an object of beauty because of both the warp and the weft. So in this case, it would be this water pot is composed of both brass and copper, which are both metals of very, very different parameters, but they come together so beautifully. So the hope I think the craftsman would have had, apart from the decorative aspect, is to make us look at this vase and contemplate on based on this to say, how can I bring out, how can I see similarities even in people who are different from me? And how can I see the similarities and differences within myself and reconcile them and blend them together? Just this is water pot is able to do. And you'll see in multiple, in the motifs that we use, in the shapes that we use, very often Ramya is there, but it's a secret that can be seen only by those who actually want to see it. And when you want to see it, you'll see it very, very easily. So you'll find that in any object of metal that was created, these three functions parameters would have been there, and because these three are there, the user will be able to elevate themselves to a higher level of inner delight and therefore feel happy. If they felt happy, they would do good deeds and therefore they would attain dharma and therefore moksha as well. And the craftsman felt that he or she was so integral in this part of helping someone achieve moksha that they thought that was moksha for them, which is why they never put their names on it and let their work speak for themselves. So using this philosophic underpinning, let us look at some of the metalware across the centuries in Tamil Nadu. The oldest, of course, that we have is from Adichanallur, but there are some examples of Chola metalware as well. These are treasure troves that are found along with the bronzes that we found. At the bottom, these two are kindis, which are water vessels. And you will see that for some reason, the shape of the spout has actually changed in the later period. We're not sure when it changed, but the older ones are, they're much more angular, and the Kerala ones have actually gone upwards. So why they had these design changes, one doesn't know, but the shape of the Chola kindis and the ancient kindis are very different from what you see today. Then on the top is a vessel which must have been used for storing water or oil. We're not sure of what it could have been, but it opens over here with the finial over here. These are two musical instruments. There are many, many records from the Chola period of musical instruments like this being given, Tuttuvari or Kumbha are some of the names that we have. Many of these were also made out of gold. Rajaraja Chola's gifts to the Brihadeeshwara temple or to Thiruvottiyur actually mentioned gold instruments being given as well. This is an Astradeva, which is an image of the weapon of the presiding deity. So for Shiva temples, it will be a Trishula, and for Vishnu temples, it will be a Sudarshana Chakra. And the Astradeva would literally would be the deity that goes before the main deity. And the Astradeva are still used in temples today. But unfortunately, these kind of images, vessels we don't see, and the kindi has also changed it. So these are more varieties of the kindi to see. All of these would have been buried in the Chola times, during invasion times or something like that. And then they have been recovered much later, and these are all in museums today to be seen. We also hear mention of a vattil. A vattil is typically a cup, which would be the half globe kind of a shape that we usually have in our kitchens. But we also have other names called a ottu vattil. The ottu vattil, some people say, could be a spittoon. And this may be a kind of a spittoon. We are not sure because we don't have a... We have inscriptions which would mention a vessel, but never an inscription which describes a vessel. So we are not very sure, but these are two lovely shapes. And you can see how the flaring on the top is imitating the petals of a lotus. Very beautiful. Both. And by the way, none of these are Sushira. They're all Ghana. So they're all actually cast the way a bronze would be cast, using a wax mold and then coating it with clay and then pouring the melted metal into it, and then the metal takes the form of the wax, and the wax oozes out of the clay mold. This is the mukkali or a three-legged stool. Usually stools in temples or vessels that were used in temples have three legs, because they give greater stability than four legs in an uneven surface. And you can see the recessed shape on the top. This must have been as a holder for a pot to be kept. And you will find we still use mukkalis at home even today, but of course not those which are so elaborately done. Again, two other vessels for water or for oil. There are many inscriptions that talk about the nari, or the amount of ghee that is needed. Nari is a quantity measure that was needed for a temple and for using for lighting the lamps. So this must have probably been some kind of a nari, and I think these levels could probably mean the measurement levels for the liquid that is poured inside. So all of these are from the Chola period. So that would be about 11th to 12th century. Deeparadhana plates, again found in excavations. Unfortunately, there must have been either multiple plates on the top or a finial on the top, which we've lost in these, but still nevertheless beautiful. And it's remarkable to see that this design has survived virtually unchanged in temples even today. These are two plates. These are two plates. They are called Sahasradharas, because there are many, many holes in them. They have two uses. One is they're used as a tray to keep offerings for the deity. They could also be used to be placed over, held over the processional deity, and water being poured inside. So it just looks like the deity is having a shower bath. And this ritual is still found in temples today. So these two are Sahasrara plates of that style. Yeah. This is, of course, a seal of the Raja of the Chola period. You can see the Chola lion and the two fish of the Pandyas, two ancient lamps. You can notice the lamps over here, very simple looking lamps. And then there is the bow at the bottom of the Chera kings. There are fly whisks and the royal parasol, which is white in color on the top. And this seal would be a part of a copper plate. Copper plates are very important. We don't have many copper plates from the Chola and the Pandya period. The few that we have are extremely important. Palavaipuram, Velvikudi are some of the copper important places where we find copper plates. And these are very lengthy inscriptions that give us a lot of information on the lineage of the Cholas and, of course, the grants that were made. Copper plates continue to be in use right up till about the 16th, 17th century. And then, of course, they were replaced by paper. So here is one example that a private collector very kindly lent to me. And you can see at the top, there are beautiful images. So this is a solid cast bronze copper plate. And you can see a cast image of Shivalinga. And there are deities on either side with the Ganesha and Anandi. And on this sheet on both sides is a lengthy inscription. And this inscription mentions the gift of a large lake and a few acres of land to an important matha or a monastery in Thanjavur. And these were actually, most of these were sold or disposed of in vessel shops in the 1970s and the 60s and the 80s, because by then legal documents had become all paper. And they didn't really need all of these at all, which is quite sad. But Madras Museum has one of the largest collection of copper plates. Fortunately, all copper plates, or at least most of them, have been deciphered, published by the Archaeological Survey of India and other local journals like Avanam and Varalar. So let's move on from the Chola ware to puja objects. The word puja literally means adoration. We don't find pujas mentioned in the Rigvedic hymns. We don't find them in the Yajurvedic hymns as well. But puja seem to have begun maybe about 3,000 odd years back, when society became more and more urban and the need was felt for ritual worship at home, which could be done without the intervention of a Brahmin priest. Who would be actually the person who would do it for yajna. So the ancient version of a puja was people got together and they did a yajna in the forest. And then the emergence of the priestly class came in, where they interceded with the yajamana to actually do the puja on his behalf. And then finally the yajamana had an option to also directly commune with God. And that was the origin of the puja that we talk about today. Patanjali is important for us when in the context of puja, because in his Yoga Sutra, he talks about the freedom for people to take on an Ishta Devata or an independent deity for whom the puja can be done. So once this was said, puja became, in one way, it became a way for the yajamana to talk directly to God without the intervention of a priest, without having to step outside and go into a temple. It also became a way to bring the community within the family together, because the entire family sat together when they did the puja. And very quickly, the puja became an aesthetic experience. And in the puja, you will find all our five senses are titillated in some way. So we have music, or we have the bell sound, we have something fragrant to smell, which is the incense, we have something tasty, which is the prasada, we have actions to do through touch, which is with our hands, and we have beautiful things to see in the form of a murti, in the form of the flowers, and in the form of beautiful art objects as well. So by about the, definitely by the 16th, 17th century, individual worship protocols had become extremely complex, and just as the temples had their agamas, individual mataadhipatis and monasteries, they advocated certain puja vidhis to their followers, and the more elaborate the ritual got, the more objects were needed, and the more objects were needed, the more craftsmanship could flourish, with metal being one of the most important ones. And you'll find in puja ware, the preferred metal is copper, then gold and silver, and iron or stainless steel is strongly discouraged, because many of these puja traditions would have been inspired by Vedic traditions, and during the Vedic times we didn't have iron, and which means iron was unknown to them, and they preferred copper because they, by that time the copper age was already there. So even today, in the most orthodox temples in Tamil Nadu, in the puja traditions, in the people who believe it guru in the old way, they will not include iron objects, they will not include stainless steel, and they certainly won't have plastic inside the puja room. This is a puja created for a Kshatriya home, and you can see all the weapons in the front. This was done during the occasion of an Ayudha Puja. So I just wanted to give you two photographs that show you the wealth of objects that can be shown in a puja room. Right, so this is from the Kshatriya period, and you'll see the Shodasha Upachara on either side, which are the different metal objects used for adoring the deity. And then, of course, all the weapons are here, which are shown to the deity over here. There are lamps over here, and this is a Kshatriya home, and then, of course, there is a tray with flowers over here. There would have been other objects over here when the ritual actually happens, but this is for I assume this is for a Dashara service, so the puja utensils would be inside the cupboard and will come out only when the actual puja happens over here. This would be the puja room for a Brahmin household, and you will find the deity is inside. This mantapa is called a Koil Aadvar for Sri Vaishnavas. There is a Deepa Lakshmi over here, and there are many, many different metal objects over here. All of these we will look at in a little bit more detail. So these are the old pattis that we talk about. This is how the kindi has become today. There is a bell, there is another taller pattil, and then this is, of course, a prasada plate for keeping Nevedya, and then there are many of the Shodasha Upachara plates as well. And let's take a double click. So I just wanted to give you a big picture of how it will look, and then we'll zoom in. So when I'm looking at all these metalware over here, one object that I'm not going to look at too much today are the ritual idols themselves. And I think they deserve a separate talk for themselves. And I think idols, somehow, because of the bronzes that most of us are familiar about, have been fairly well talked about and documented. It is these smaller objects of decorative art that find no mention in all the big books. And they deserve to be also known to the larger world. This is from a private collection of a puja mantapa. Usually mantapas are made out of wood. This is unusual to see it made out of brass, and though there are sometimes silver as well. The reapers over here would have been covered by a pleat cloth, and my sense is these holes would have actually had provisions for little bells or little shapes of flowers or some kind of a toran, or maybe even mango leaf to be strung through that in a decorative way. When the deity is placed on the puja mantapa, an avahana is done. And when the avahana is done, the deity is no longer identified with that metal or that stone or even the ammonite puzzle or the spatikalinga, but the deity is seen as divine by itself. The way to see it is, the universe is incomprehensible, cosmos is undefinable. With our limited vocabulary, we cannot even understand it, let alone define it. But for the sake of focusing my energy to work on seeing the Brahman within myself and within others, I need a via media, and the idol becomes that. So the idol is not an idol by itself. It is a representation of the cosmos that I cannot define, but I want to define, because when I can define the cosmos, then I can see it within myself and within other people as well. And that is where when I see many, many antique shops which have a lot of these miniature idols that would have belonged to homes, my heart actually, it cries a little bit, because those idols would have been worshipped not just as idols or just even for their artistic merit, right? Even people like me, I would just look at a bronze, I'd say, oh, this is a Chola period. It's the history that's important for me more than the devotion. But those images would have been worshipped with so much of devotion that it must have been a heart-rending moment when they were taken away from the family home and they've ended up in some antique shop somewhere. So if you have them at home, maybe you can't do a puja for it, but at least look at them with that sense of affection as well, because the person who created it and the person who used it would have seen that kind of an affection in them. This is another mantapa. This comes from a Madhwa Brahmin house in Tanjavur, And you can see here that there is a later more Mughal and a Marathi influence in the shape of the dome and in the shape of the cusp arch as well. And they would have multiple deities inside. Now, this is something unusual that that one finds with antique dealers in Tamil Nadu here and there, but I've not been able to find much about it. And I think in a way, this is indicative of a problem that we have in decorative arts in India. There are no books available. Craftsmen today have lost the purpose of many of the objects that we find in antique collectors' homes. And the community of antique dealers who have actually gone to houses, gone to vessel shops and bought these old things directly has decreased to almost, I think, 2 or 3 in Tamil Nadu, as far as I know. All the people who are dealers today, they all sit in their shops and do business through WhatsApp. So it's very difficult to find out where did the object come from, what is the region that it came from, what is the community it came from, because the region, the community, the time period, all of these define the design and the use of the object. So I don't even have a consensus on what these are called. And I would be very grateful if somebody of you knows something about this, tell me about it. But what I have heard is you find these in Rauji houses. So Rao is a very colloquial word for calling Madhva Brahmins or Teshastha Brahmins in the Tanjavur Kumbakonam region. You find it only there. In the Kaveri Delta, in Kumbakonam, Tiruvarur, Nagapattinam, that region is only where you find this. Some dealers tell me that a mirror is placed in the middle. Some dealers tell me there is a little cradle with a baby, not a Krishna, but a baby in that. So anyone's good guess on what it is. But they look quirky and we don't know much about them. But this is indicative of the problem that we have and the need for decorative arts to be documented, to be written about, especially in terms of what region they came from and what community they came from. This is a later version of the Mukali. This you will find very frequently in the Chettinad homes, because anything sacred should not be kept on the floor. It should be kept a little raised. And you'll find even, for example, if they are using a vessel filled with milk, either for a prasada or for a marriage function or something, they can't keep it on the floor. They will keep it on a mukali like this. Usually mukalis are made out of wood. Very often you find them made out of brass and sometimes out of silver as well. They're always beautifully engraved on the top. This one has a hamsa in the middle. So if we did the ramya for the hamsa is a bird that was so pure of heart that in a mixture of milk and water, it could drink the milk and leave the water aside. So every time the artist put a hamsa there, And a patron looked at the hamsa, the patron would remind herself or himself that there is a lot of bad stuff in the world today. Let's take the good and let's leave the bad behind, just like the hamsa bird. This would look like a lamp at a glance, but it's not a lamp. This is a receptacle for the shalagrama, which is the sacred stone, which is an ammonite fossil that Vaishnavas worship in Tamil Nadu. So the stone, the shalagrama stone is very small. It's in fact, the smaller it is that you can actually clasp it within your right palm is the more powerful it is. And that stone would have resided over here in some very staunch Vaishnavite's home. And you have the Garuda in the front kneeling in obeisance, very, very beautifully crafted. This would be from about the 19th century or maybe even the 18th. Hastas. In homes as well, in temples, during decorations, when they wanted much larger, when they wanted a greater variety of decorations and postures shown for the deity, they would use hastas like this, usually made out of gold, sometimes inset with gemstones as well. And these are some, and you'll find them in homes as well, because during, say, Paralakshmi Vratham and occasions like that, an image is created in the home just using cloth and using hastas like this. For those kind of images, sometimes you need to start with a kumbha full of water. And the water is very sacred for us. It's one of our most important elements. On the top of this chumbu or this kumbha, which is on the kalasha on the left side, a coconut and mango leaves will be placed, filled, and they will be filled with water. And then the image of a face will be adorned with it. This is a unique kumbha because it's got the, face of a woman or of the Devi painted on, etched on this itself. So quite unique to see it. And then you can see the very fine lines of workmanship over here. This came from a dealer in Tanjavur district again, possibly about the 19th century or the early 20th century. In all Hindu homes, the tulsi is extremely important. In fact, the correct way to take a tulsi, there's a whole lot of rules and regulations around it, that you can't pluck it in the night. You should have had a bath before you go and pluck it. And you should not pluck a leaf, but you should pick the top part. And because tulsi is the plant that came up during the Amrita Mantham, when the Mount Meru hit the Arkadal or the Milky Ocean, and when the drops of the ocean splashed on the Meru mountain, that's when tulsi was supposed to be born. In the Tanjore district, in the Madhwa homes, for them the tulsi was very important. The tulsi puja was very important. We would find large, you know, even 1 foot, 1.5 feet tall brass cast tulsi madams, inside which an earthen pot would be placed. So this is one like that, and you can see it even has recesses for the lamps to be placed. This is one of our grandest photographs. It was taken by Alexander Rhea from the Archaeological Survey of India in about 1850. These show all the metalware in the Adi Kumbeshwara temple in Kumbakonam. I doubt if the temple even has all of this today, but you'll find the Shodashopachara. We need to talk a little bit about this. By about 1800 years back, the kings in Tamil Nadu had figured out a solution for one of their most worrying problems, which was how do they prove legitimacy to the people they are ruling? Because one is for the king to order something to be done, and then the people will do it, which is compliance. But they wanted commitment. So they chose to align themselves closer with religion. So by about 1,500 years back, everything that happened in the palace happened in the temple. And the god equaled king. So even the Tamil word for Kovil, for temple is Kovil, which does not mean house of God. It actually means house of the king. So all the rituals that happened in the palace happened in the temple and vice versa, which meant the number of objects that were used was much higher. So this, for example, the umbrella. The white umbrella is a symbol of royalty. You find that in the Shodashopachara. You find the visiri or the fan, which is a symbol of royalty. You find that in the temple as well. The Kumbharati, will come back to later, a very unique shape of a lamp. And then you find the Argajam, the different kinds of deepa. So here you can see a Nandi deepa. They must have had wicks over here. It must have been a blazing, beautiful sight when they've used it. Here is a Sarpa deepa. They would have kept wicks on the top and they would have waved it 3 times in a clockwise motion. This is a Purushamruga deepa. Purushamruga was an ardent devotee of Shiva. So that's a deepa over there. This is a Dupakal. These two are receptacles for keeping sacred ash. This is the bell over here. This is the tattali, which either could be the mirror or could be the symbol of the sun. So you show it in front of the deity and you take it off. Sadly, many temples don't have most of these today. And those that have it, usually they have fairly modern ones. You don't see them with as much of beautiful workmanship as you used to see in the past and in photographs like this. In the Madurai region, we still have some of these gorgeous Prabhavalis created. These are from about the 17th or the 18th century. The Meenakshi Amman temple had 4 or 5 of them. In fact, one was given by Thirumala Nayaka, and it has a small image of him over there also. Sadly, one was dismantled and melted and sold in the 1970s, but the remaining ones are there. They're worth going and seeing. In the Kanchipuram Perundevi goddess shrine, on the steps, they have been molded into brass, and on the corner you can actually see a tiny image of Krishnadevaraya, because he was the one who commissioned that, and it's actually like it's equal to a 17th century bronze. We use it as a step, and sadly the devotees who go to the temple would not even look down and see it. It's right at the corner. So this is in Tirupulani. It's a lovely Prabhavali, massive, commissioned by the Ramanathapuram Zameen. And I can show you a close-up image right over here. You can see the ferocious teeth of the Prabhavali right at the top. And then there is a Thiruman, which indicates that this is a Vaishnava temple. lamps. We can do a whole session on lamps. I'm going to show you very, very few. Some of the more unusual ones. Some of the lamps in the old days were designed with a process for allowing us to regulate the height of the lamp. So this is where the wick goes. This can be unscrewed. And if you move this to the bottom, this can go rotate. This can move anywhere on this on the column over here. On the top here is a kinnara. A kinnara is a mythical beast, which was half bird, half woman or man. And they were very, very adept at music. And you'll usually find a kinnara with a veena. She doesn't have a veena here, but she's pretending to play one over here. Kinnara is a kind of it's a motif that India forgot. But Burmese cultures and Burmese works of art frequently have the kinnara in them. This is another side view of the kinnara. You can see the very beautiful way in which the craftsman has actually done her tail. This is a lamp, of course. The wooden base has come much later. Again, it can move up and down. A very unusual shape. Looking at the shape, one can surmise that this may be from about the 17th century, and it's got a galloping yali over here, quite unusual. This is a lamp which is quite ornate, maybe from the 19th century. This is unique over here. It looks like one bird, but actually there are many little birds. So there's a bird over here, there's another one over here, there are two over here, then there is some engraved on the side. So you have to look at it very, very carefully to see all the birds, and they're all parrots. And the Ramya element for a parrot is that the parrot is a bird of love. So every time you see a parrot, you look at how you can love yourself and love others also as well. This is a more Maratha-influenced lamp from Tanjavur in Kumbakonam again. Quite florid, but quite elegant. It's a small lamp. It's about a foot and a half high. Just wanted to show you. It's a very intricate workmanship. One of the best books on brassware and metalware in the beginning of the 21st century is by Edgar Thurston and Velusami Asari. It's a very rare book. It was very expensive. It was about 120 rupees when it was published in the 1910s by the government presidency. That has a lot of line drawings of the finest brassware of that time. These are pavai velakas, or ladies holding a lamp. This tradition, this design came to us from Roman times. And then in South India, especially in Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, they took it to a very, very beautiful extreme. This is from the Tirunelveli region. You can make out it's from the Tirunelveli region because of the style of the sari and because of her headgear as well. We'll come to that in a minute. This is a 5 foot high lamp, which is found even today in Thiruvadai Marathur, near Kumbakonam. It's got a story attached to it. Amarasimha was the ruler of Thiruvadai Marathur. He was quite a wicked man, actually. His son, Pratapasimha, died very young. And he died at a time when he had just got engaged to a lady. And this is the lady's image. So his fiance was so distraught that she lost her fiance, that she decided not to marry again, and she became a widow. So everything the widow did in the 18th century, she did to herself. And one last time, she wore all the good jewelry that she had, and she had a sculptor fashion this lamp in her very image, and she has given it to the temple. The lamp and the story is still there. Photos don't do justice to the lamp. And for those of you who love your textiles and your jewelry, definitely a must go to have a look at that lamp. This is the Tirunelveli style kondai that this lady is wearing, which tells us this is from Tirunelveli, and this is all the jewelry that Deepamba is wearing in the back, and well worth seeing. This is in Thiruvadai Marathur. This is a very unique lamp from Madurai again, of a mother and child holding a lamp. The inscription at the bottom says that this was given by a grateful woman to a temple in Madurai in thanks for having given birth to a baby, which was her vow. And she had fulfilled the vow by giving this lamp. So the tradition of giving a lamp fashioned out of metal in one's own image is from the Chola period. We have inscriptions of queens giving lamps and sometimes kings also giving lamps. Sadly, from the Chola and that period, none have survived. But in private collections and in museums, there are many of these kind of lamps of women, or very rarely men holding lamps. which are from mostly from the 17th and the 18th century. Some temples have them as well. Some of the finest ones are in the Chidambaram temple, in the Srirangam temple, and in the Trivandrum Padmanabha Swami temple. This is Val Changalavatta is what it is called in Kerala. In Tamil Nadu, it's called a Val Valakku. It would usually have a hole over here and a chain and a spoon. And the idea is this will hold oil. So if you had to light many lamps at a point of time, rather than bringing each lamp and going and lighting it and leaving it there, you take this and you move to each lamp and you actually light the lamp over there. Usually these kind of lamps are much more simpler. This is a very, very unique piece. And I was told by the owner that they actually found it in a riverbed. So what would have happened in those days is this lamp would have got damaged. And in those days, you can't take an object that belongs to a temple outside the temple. So it either has to be buried within the temple in a place where footsteps cannot be passed over it, or it would be thrown into the water, into a sea or a river. And this person was lucky enough to find it over there. Definitely from the 19th century, if not the 18th century, looking at the style of workmanship. Another variant of the Deepa Lakshmi is to see it on an elephant. The elephant in Tamil Nadu, in Tamil literature, has long been considered an object of grace, beauty, and royalty. And it's only appropriate that you find it in temples as well. This is from about the 17th century. There's an inscription there which dates it to that period. This is a much simpler version of it. Sometimes these elephants come with wheels as well. So they were used as toys. This one you will notice is different, and I put it here to show you how a Karnataka version will look. And in a Karnataka version, you'll find the breasts have a very decorative circle around them. The nipples are shown in a very spherical structure, and these large earrings, disc-shaped earrings are shown, and there is a flare in the front and an exaggerated flare to the side as well. So these are some indications that these are from Karnataka. The Mada Velakku is a lamp that usually big-time collectors would not have bought in the old days. A Mada is two alcoves that you will find on either side of an entrance to a traditional house. And these lamps would be lit there in the evening. I remember my own grandmother doing it in our village house. Every evening she would light two lamps on the Mada. These lamps would shed their light on the entrance and on the tinnai, or the raised portion of the house where a tired wayfarer can rest. So I'm assuming that these lamps would have also shed some light for the wayfarer to maybe eat something and read something and go to sleep. Mada Velakkas in the heydays of collecting, which are the 80s and the 90s and the 70s, not many people would have bought them because they look the same. Some of them even look very folkish or crudish. So the classical collectors would not buy it. But I stumbled upon more information when I had, over a period of a year and a half, I had collected about 200 of these for my son's thread ceremony. And that is when I actually noticed that there is so much in the history of Mada Velakkas that we need to be documenting, because every region in Tamil Nadu had variations. So these would be from the Karaikal region. This would be from Nagarkoil, because you have a very large Christian population over there. And this kind of a spiked motif would be found only in the Tirunelveli, Madurai, and the Karaikudi, and that region. And in a Mada Velakku, I'm going to show you another one here, which is slightly more elaborate. I want you to see how the three principles have been used. So you have first is Bogadhyam, which is utilitarianism. So the angle for where the wick is placed is perfectly aligned so that no soot falls beyond the rim. There is no soot that falls over here. It falls rightly over here. And because the wick is shaped in a very in an angle to the oil inside, the capillary action is very even, and the flame glows for a long time without getting extinguished very soon. So that is Bogadhyam principle number one. The second is, if you notice, he's left a very large rim over here, and this is to prevent spillage from falling on the floor. The third thing, you can't quite see it over here, is the middle part is actually raised, because in a lamp you want the wick to get all the oil which is to the side. So automatically, because the oil goes to the lower side, the central portion is raised. And even over here, he has not left it empty. He has engraved a little lotus over here. So all of these are symbols of Bogadyam, simple utilitarian ways. And the final thing that you can see is, you can see just about here is a little hole. And this hole would have had a stick, a rod made out of metal again. And that rod would have been used for you to regulate the length of the wick and therefore the quality of the flame. So it's a simple lamp. And you will see the principles of utilitarianism used so carefully, which is, means the craftsman would have actually thought so much about how the person would have actually used the lamp. These are more examples. And you will see from the Karaikal region, you will see these kind of amsas of, on the top. Again, you know what amsa meaning is. Kamakshi lamps, which are much grander, you will find the Lakshmi image at the back. Another version of a Kamakshi lamp, which is much more grand. You have one Lakshmi and you have two little mini lamps over here. The Prabhavali is done in a very cusped arch shape, very grandly done with the Kirti Mukha on the top. This lamp, you can't quite see it well over here, but this bottom part is actually a container for water. And you pour the water from the back. So just to describe it, it's not there in this one. But there is a container at the bottom and you have a recess on the back to pour water. And that meant that you could touch the lamp at the bottom and hold it and move it without your feet getting, without your hands getting hot, because this part can become quite hot with the oil and the flame. So that's the kind of thought process that they would have put through that. And then, of course, you have the humble Ahal Velakku, which is a very simple diya, which you'll find in many of the old houses. The same kind of care. You will see that the angle is perfect. There is a, in some of these, you will find a decorative element in the front and you will find a concave shape over here for the oil to stagnate on the sides. Yeah, this is an Abhisheka Patra for keeping the deities in the middle and to give perform Abhisheka for it. Different kinds of kindis. We saw how the shape of the Chola kindi was and you see how the shape of the kindi has changed now. Sometimes you will find kindis with beautiful engraving over here as well. These are relatively simpler ones. This kindi is again from about the 17th or the 18th century. It's quite unique because it still shows the old Chola pattern. This is a vattil, the way that is used in temples today. And I just wanted to show it to you for the elegant shape. And this shape you will find in some of the older paintings as well. So the shape has remained virtually unchanged. Yeah? Panchapatram and Udrini, or a Kolapatram is how some people will call it. This is for personal use. So the water is inside this. The Udrini is the spoon for which you take the water. And these are used in temples. And you will see different kinds of Udrinis, the more complicated ones with the sectarian symbols here. There's a Sudarshana Chakra over here, may have actually been used in temples. And even over here, you will see this little graceful indenture over here. And it makes it easy to grasp the Panchapatra or the Kolapatram. And these, even today, you find them, but certainly the quality is not so good. The octagonal shaped ones are probably from Karnataka, because in Tamil Nadu, the shape is very traditional. It's either bent in the middle or it's a very straight cylinder as it is over here. Sometimes they come with little feet as well so that they can stand stably. And Udrinis, there are very, very different types. The common one is got a snake on the top, but there are then sometimes you have a Krishna, you have Hanuman, you might have the Sudarshana Chakra and many others as well. And the end of the Udrini is also very beautifully shaped, like the half Yali and the half Simha over here. This symbol is, if you look carefully, it's got the face of a Yali, which signals bravery, and it has the body of a parrot, which shows love. So it's it reminds us that we need to be brave and we need to love as well. And you'll find this a lot in the weapons, actually, because it tells a soldier to fight with bravery for the country and with love as well. This is a mirror, which is a part of the Shodasha Upachara. So you show it to the deity and you show it to the after the decorations have been done. And it's got little bells over here to make a little tinkling sound. This could be a Thattali or it could be a Surya Prabhai. Again, to show to the deity Surya, because you show the deity that the deity is the sun reflected on himself. It's a sign of royalty and auspiciousness as well. Yeah. This is a royal standard for Garuda. Again, this would be shown in front of the deity in a domestic worship. the flag, and this will be waved in the front. And there are ways in which you show it. It's not just you show it and you keep it. Each of these have very different hand movements as well. So there's a lot of usage of the hands in the puja as well. And that is what causes an elevated experience. The fly whisks, very beautifully done out of silver. You have the visiri or the fan. This is a relatively simpler example. Different kinds of deepas. We saw some in the Kumbakonam photograph. This is the Meru Deepa, which is very unusual. You have the Meru head, Sapta Deepas. There seems to be some devotee. There's a Nandi over here. And the wicks would be placed on the top. And imagine so much of workmanship. And this Deepa will be used only 5 times daily. And they would be used only once. So they will just be used once and they'll be kept aside. Even for that, so much of attention to detail and care for craftsmanship. This is very unique. This is a Kurma Deepa, which is in the shape of a tortoise. The wicks would have been placed here. Again, this would have been used only one point of time. You don't find this in temples at all. There's another version, and here there's a provision for camphor as well, and these would have been for wicks. I have not found this in temple rituals, so we've completely lost this habit. This is a Deepa Lakshmi, again, another Deepa, but here there's a lady standing on the top, and this has an inscription over here which mentions that this was donated by a particular lady in about 1798. These are, again, either they're deepas or they're incense burners. So you'll find the incense was the live coals, and you pour incense or powder on the top and they would have burned. So this brings the aroma and the fragrance to the puja. This is a Kumbha Arati. The Kumbha Arati continues to be used in the temple, but this was used only by the Devadasis. The last aarti was taken for the deity after the procession or at the end of the day by the Devadasi using the Kumbha Arati, and they light one wick on the top. And this was the lamp that the Devadasi would light to remove all the evil eye that has been cast on the deity. And the only woman who could do that was the Nitya Sumangali, the one who always had all the auspiciousness about her, which was the Devadasi. So anytime you find this in a temple, it's done by a male today, but it was done by a Devadasi. And I think pause a minute, shed a tear for that community of wonderful women whom we ostracized. And when we banned their services, we lost a lot of our art, dance, music, and identity as well. And we find many bells in temples. This is a simpler version. There are more complex versions with multiple bells. Here are some bells used in home worship as well. This is, of course, a Vaishnavite bell with conch. This is a Vaishnavite bell. It has the Hanuman and the Garuda on either side. Madhwas have bells which have only the Hanuman. The Nandi is, of course, for the Shiva temple. The boar, I'm not so sure. This may have come from Kerala. It may be for Varaha. It may be sometimes for Ganesha as well. The elephant is usually not for Ganesha as you would imagine, but actually for Muruga or Kartikeya, because Kartikeya's original Vahana was the elephant and not the peacock, because he was the god of war. Another more elaborate incense burner. This one has a provision to close it so that the coal doesn't damage anybody's skin. Again, beautiful incense burners. These would have been on the top of wooden poles, and they would have been carried along in a procession, which is where the pole would have gone. This is not just a decorative motif. This is an arasa yela, or the leaf from a peepal tree, symbolizing royalty. And this must have definitely been from a temple. This is too large for a home domestic use. This one is from a temple in the Tamraparni region. And he shows the 4 important Chaivite saints on all sides. This is Thiringana Samandar on one side. Look at the sizes. This is my finger, and look at the level of detail he's got on this tiny bronze over here. Not sure when this was made, probably 19th or 18th century. Fortunately, still in use, but very damaged. The top is gone, the bottom, all these pieces are broken, but it's still used. And hopefully they will use it well and not destroy it. Another kind of incense burner. This time it has bells, which I'm sure would have jingled as the holder of the incense burner would have gone along with the procession in the temple. This is a 2-in-1. You've got the incense burner on the top and you have lamps at the bottom as well. This is possibly a Bhasma Chatti, which is for storing sacred ash, and it's got a Nandi at the top. Very beautiful piece of workmanship. Another incense burner. This time it's got Garuda on all sides and it stands on a tall pedestal so that the priest wouldn't have had to bend down and lift it. close a few of that. These are camphor burners. Looking at Hanuman over here, this must have been for a Rama temple. Looking at the Nandi, this would have been for a Shiva temple. The camphor would have burned on all these sides, and this would have been used for the Karpur Arati, which is an important part of towards the end of the puja. This is a pitli. Even the word is lost out of the vocabulary today. Pitlis are used for storing oil. And if you look at this, the spout is very tall so that it can go to the corner of the lamp. And you have just one hole for the oil to pass through. And even here, see, these turns of the metal are just to connect these two places for structural stability. But even here, he's echoed a twist in echoing to the Brahmamudi knot over here. That's the level of thought that he's had. This pithili design you find in Sri Lanka as well, not just in Tamil Nadu, but you find in Sri Lanka as well. Another version of the pithili is this shape where this part screws open for the oil to go in. This you find more often in Karnataka than in Tamil Nadu. But today, they use plastic bottles. I've never seen in temples actually use these. And they would use these for either for the oil lamps or for putting a little bit of oil on the flaming torches. This is a basma chatti or a receptacle for keeping sacred ash. More basma chattis with ferocious images of Kala Bhairava. So these are clearly for a Shiva temple. Another one, this is from the Jagdish Mittal Museum in Hyderabad. This is a two-in-one. So you have a place for sacred ash, and you have a tiny compartment for kumkum as well. And then if you're too tired to pass it on to the next person, you can actually shove it on the floor and it will wheel itself across. These are two receptacles for keeping sacred ash found in Shiva temples. This is for keeping puja prasad in homes. And this is from a Chettiar home. So these five would have been used for sacred ash, for turmeric, for kumkum, maybe for sandalwood paste as well. This is a fly whisk, a fan using peacock feathers, a relatively simpler metal holder. Some of them could be more complex. And then, of course, you have the bronzes, you have jewelry, and you have the Sri Shatari. The Shatari is the crown with the Vishnupada on the top, which is used to reduce the ego, the ahankara in the devotees. And you find this service only in Vishnu temples in Tamil Nadu. And these are also very beautiful works of art. This one is from Nanganeri, where you find an image of Namarvar on the Shatari, which is very unique. You usually find only Vishnu's feet of Paduka on the top. This is for home use. This is a small silver container to keep the Thiruman and the Kumka, the Sri Churnam, which is what Vaishnavites apply on their forehead. So it's all, everything is there. You've got the mirror to see yourself do it. You've got the stick to apply it. You've got the holder for the Sri Churnam, and you've got the box to put all of that inside. And even the handle on the top is a little Krishna. He's not done a simple handle. He's done it very, very beautifully. And usually these are made out of basket weaves. And I think the artist has imitated that weave over here, though he's done it out of silver. And then you have the Vaishnavite marks on this side. This is a Madhwa seal. And these would be used by Madhwas. They would be dipped lightly in sandal and they would be placed on the shoulder. And you find these in silver, you find these in bronze quite often. So moving on from the ritual objects, let's look at some of the kitchen objects, though not much. This is a spittoon from a Chettiar home. I've just given you a size with the soft water soda bottle. This would have been used during large gatherings of in Chettiar weddings and so on and so forth, when many people would have been chewing paan or betla, and they would all need a sufficiently large vessel to spit this in. I mean, once it's well washed and all that, you can definitely use it as a planter, because I don't know how many people chew paan to fill up a big vessel like this. Yeah. This is Swami work. This was pioneered in Madras, and PR and Sons was one of the most important makers of Swami work. Almost all Swami work went from India to the UK as export. Even the word Swami work comes from there, because the preferred designs on these brassware was silvered images of gods and goddesses. There are some absolutely beautiful Swamiware which comes up for auction in England very often, of tea sets, which hold processions and deities and in all kinds of combinations, very beautifully done, all for export. Seldom found in India, very often found in auctions and abroad, especially in the UK. This is a pot with lovely parrots on either side. I couldn't find much more about it. from South India, very beautifully done, a water pot. I thought I should show it just for the parrots and for the workmanship on the rim. This is our humble vegetable cutter, done in a very elaborate fashion in iron. This is again from the Mittal Museum in Hyderabad. And this is, of course, in reclining position, otherwise it would be on the top. Sometimes these come with a coconut scraper as well, made out of iron, very functional object. But look at the level of detail that he has put in over here, the craft. Our humble Thookachatti, which is a very elegant shape, and it's got a cover as well. This is for making savories like muruku and tengural and so on and so forth. Put the dough inside and put the filler of the wedge over here, and then you screw it on the top. And then as you press this through, you get the batter on the hot oil and you have something tasty to have with coffee. No, that reminds me, when we talk about coffee, South Indian coffee always tastes good because it comes out of filters like this. You put the decoction on the top and you put the hot water on the boiling hot water on the top and you wait for the water to come through these little holes into the decoction at the bottom, and this is the decoction that you use to mix with your milk. This is just a very utilitarian piece of workmanship. It's done out of brass, but look at the beauty of the finial and the way he's done the lid. He could have just done a straight lid and put the finial on the top. This is Sukhadarshana in action. And even over here, there are these symmetrical lines. This is a very humble utilitarian object. He needn't have done any of this decoration. Look at the pride of craftsmanship that he had. So much of effort gone into something as humble as this. So if you want to have good coffee, you've got to make it with stuff like this, not just by mixing stuff that you buy or even through a Starbucks coffee. A winnow used to take rubbish from the kitchen. Even that has such beautiful workmanship right in the middle. And it's got a little ring on the top so that you can hang it in the wall and save space at the bottom. Lot of thought, even for these small kitchen utensils, lot of attention to Bogadhyam, Ramya, and Sukhadarshana. Yeah, this is a sevanai to make string hoppers. You put the dough inside this and you keep twisting this, and it comes out at the bottom all steamed up and ready to eat. Kujas were our old water bottles. This is called a Mundri Kuja because it resembles the shape of a cashew nut. This is called a Urunda Kuja because it's just round in shape. So the words that you use for these are actually very colloquial, and there's an article of mine somewhere in the Hindu about a peep into grandma's kitchen. Much more information over there on these kind of vessels. This is a bosi, which is used to serve rasam, rarely found in kitchens today. You find this across Tamil Nadu. How many different vessels? You can see these lovely tiffin carriers over here. They're just two shots of how old antique vessel shops used to look like. We have another one over here. We have a few lamps here, a lot. These are all boxes for keeping betel leaves. This is a humble water pot, but he's used the Ganga Jamuna technique. The Ganga Jamuna technique is to use two metals in one. Swami work was using silver on brass. This is copper on brass. Kai Urali, which is used for tempering mustard and curry leaves and so on and so forth before you cook, or maybe even heating ghee and cooking small quantities. This is for making deep fried version of idlis, which is paniyarams, and which are both sweet and savory. Mortar and pestle. Mukulota, this is for children who can't drink out of the regular tumblers. You have a little muku or a nose, and then it becomes easier for them to drink using this. And even here, look at the elegance. He's put little feet at the bottom so that it is stable, and he has lines over here as a decorative element. This is a container that you don't find often, you don't find in kitchens at all today, but they were used for storing salt. And salt containers were always shaped like this. I'm not sure why. And it has a long handle in the back, very short container, it's about that big. But and the lid swivels in and out. If you find this in Tanjavur mostly, I've seen it in Tirunelveli as well a little bit, but I'm not sure why this particular shape for salt containers. There must have been some reason, not sure why. And that's how it looks on the side. And look at the bottom, he's shown a little parrot's face. You could have just left this empty with a glob, but there's a little parrot's face and it's got legs over here, and all the side is ornamented as well. Yeah. This is a vessel. It's just a lota. And again, you see Bogadhyam over here. The central part is very high. And this is special because the bottom is conceived of in such a way that regardless of how carelessly you keep it, the center of gravity will revert to the bottom and the vessel will not spill to the side. So usually this was used to store oil or milk. And even if you keep it without your focus on it and you tilt it and keep it, it will still swing to the correct size and the liquid inside will not fall out. A very small aspect at the bottom, but very useful to have a clean kitchen at home. This is called just a chatti. This you find only in Karaikudi, in the Chettiar houses. Very beautifully engraved. I just want you to see the floral pattern over here. This is Sushira, of course. This would be beaten out of metal. And even in the back, nobody will see the bottom. And even there, he has done beautiful engraving work. This is probably a lotus motif. Some other objects, I couldn't figure out where to put them in. Karagattam is a very popular folk dance in Tamil Nadu. Now, of course, it's been hijacked by film numbers, but in the old days, they had their own unique repertoire. It is where a woman or a man as well, sometimes they hold a pot or many pots on their head and they dance. And one of the high points of a Karagattam is when they have multiple pots like this with wicks of flames going through them and they would dance. Obviously, only the best Karagattam artists would do it. Folk artists, it's very rare to see high quality metal work. They would have usually made do with very cheaper commodities like terracotta. Very unique. So this may have belonged to a temple or really to a master artist. And enormously detailed workmanship of the face. This is of Devi, of Amman on the top. And you have these peepal tree finials again over here. And each of these would have had wicks of flaming flames, and they would have been on the head, and the view and the expertise would have been the artist being able to dance complicated dance without the pots falling off from each other. And by the way, each of these pots are not welded to each other; they're all independent pots. So when the dancer is dancing, not only is this pot important, all of these should be standing straight. This is a kumbu or an instrument which is still used in Tamil Nadu today. And you'll find frequently lots of bells attached to it. Thalam, which is an instrument that is used, two metal discs. This is a manuscript cover. Manuscript covers are usually found in ivory and in wood. This one is unusually found out of metal. This one is a step. It's a step of an old bullock cart. And it would have actually had a longer panels, again made out of metal, sheet metal, which has been embossed with a little yali design to prevent the mattress of the bullock cart from falling over. So such a small utilitarian object, but look at the amount of detail that they put into it. You can just about see little parrots engraved over here, and there's a lion engraved over here. And of course, brass is not the strongest metal for this. So actually inside there is an iron core. And over the iron core, to make it more decorative, they've used brass. So this must have obviously belonged to the bullock cart, must have belonged to a very wealthy person, or certainly somebody who was very aesthetically minded. The hardware, we never notice this too much. Look at the keyhole over here and the doorknob over here. There are many old villages with many old house doors. But one of the most unusual ones I've seen is in a village called Arvarthinagri, which is deep down south. Most of the houses there have very, very unusual looking door knobs. This is, of course, a plainer one, but there is a chakram, there's a, you know, different kind of knob, and they all have, many of these have these kind of old hardware. I just want to put this out here because to give you a sense of variety in which metal was used in the homes and not just in the bronzes and in the puja room. Door knockers. Usually these door knockers will come with the sheet metal, which is in the shape of a chandra or a crescent moon, so that when you knock on the door, this metal doesn't go and damage the wood. It'll actually fall on the brass crescent shaped plate. Another keyhole, and the key would have been just as big. I've seen keys which are as much as even a foot long. And then you have, these are called Sri Lankan chairs. They probably, they came from Sri Lanka, or they were made in that style, usually made out of ebony, sometimes out of teak wood as well. Look at all the metal work over here. There's a lot of the hardware in metal that we don't talk about too much, also worth documenting and knowing a little bit about. A safe, this is actually from my ancestral home. And I remember playing with this as a child. This was made in Srivilliputtur and very complicated system of locks. So you have to first unlock this. Then you have to push this and then swivel the door, dial. And when you did that, this would become loose and you twist the handle. And then you would go and pull this. So this one you push, this one you pull at the bottom, and you pull it and you rotate it anti-clockwise. And then this hand will be free to move. So these hands, then you'll have to move in to a particular posture. And only when you do, after you've done that, you open this. Actually, this used to be in a much better condition. People like me as a child, we used to play with this so much and irritate our older people in the house. It's permanently become damaged. Otherwise, you could have actually not seen the split over here. And you then open this. After you open this and then you twist the hands, the door will actually open. So that is the kind of complexity. And these are one of the simpler ones. There are far more complicated safes. And over here, you can actually see the name of the safe maker. Who's this? Ramaswamy Acharya, I think, from Srivilliputtur. And there's another dial somewhere which will mention my great-great-great-grandfather's name as well. So this was custom made for him. And I have been told that the safe moved here during his time and nobody's been ever able to move it because there's a solid iron on either side. And actually, if you bang it on the side, it won't even sound like metal. It'll actually sound like a wall. Oh, this is a madam. This is, of course, a closed-up madam. These kind of lamps would have gone inside madams like this. Yeah, my grandparents closed it up later. But otherwise, you would have had a provision here to keep a madam. So you would have had the lamp here to light this area for people to use the safe in the night. This is a temple door, which is about 35 feet long. And this is again from Tirunelveli. Sadly, most of these doors have been dismantled and sold to antique dealers. A few still remain. And I strongly campaign for these kind of doors to be preserved in museums, because you can't make new doors like this. And we're not talking about the door here. We're talking about these finials. These are always made out of iron, never out of brass or bronze, always iron. And they were made in this shape to dissuade elephants from battering the door open. Because in those days, villagers would stay in the temple during a battle. And a king would win a battle only if he had elephants. And look at the workmanship. Iron, all of these are iron. And this is the kind of workmanship that you see over here. Nobody has documented this. In fact, my suspicion is when these doors are sold, they are sold for the wood and for the woodwork. And I think the iron just gets melted. They don't even see them as art objects. This is from a Chettiar function called Poppi Kottruzhu, which happens a day after Pongal. And this is an event for people to showcase the young women in their family. It's a fairly complex ritual. I will not get into it, but it's sad that I don't think most young Chettiars, if they even see these, I'm sure they won't even understand what it is. So the young unmarried women have to take these items to the village pond. They do a ritual over there. Then they also go to the temple. They do a little dance over there and they come back. I'll just explain what these are, and they're all really tiny, so you can see that by the 10 rupee coin. This is one half of a coconut shell. This is the root, the tuber of a palm tree. These are all I'm not sure, must be flowers of some sort. You need a Ganesha image. There would be a Surya and a Chandra, and this would be a lump of jaggery. And then you would have Betla Paka, which is betel leaf and areca nut, and one banana. So this is a complete set. All of this would be taken. This one is made out of brass, but I have seen sets made out of silver and some out of gold as well. A forgotten ritual that we know today only because these metal objects have survived from that. Yeah. Every child's play dream in those days would have been a chokku saman set. You would have chokku made out of turned wood, you'd have them made out of stone, and you have these made out of metal as well. All of these are cast metal, so it's done in the same style as a chola bronze, not the sheet metal type. You'll see all kinds of fun things over here. So there's a miniature spittoon. This is actually, by the way, this is a hand of a 10-year-old child. Yeah. So you see a spittoon over here. You see a little tuka. There's a little ear chumbu for making rasam. This is a water pump in those days. You have a bosi, which we saw. These are two different. This is a grinder. This is a pounder. This is another kind of grinder. This is your old firewood stove. This is a matte, which is a ladle for, this is a whisk for buttermilk. There's a little lamp over here, a madavela kind of a lamp. This is a beet leaf cutter. This is a very, very oval-shaped plate that is used only for sandal in puja functions. And this is, of course, your vegetable cutter. And it's got a two-in-one over here. There's a coconut scraper as well. Yeah, this is all the things that you see. One that I can show you here is this tiny. And this is, again, made out of the cast bronze process. So imagine the craftsman would have made a wax model of this and then coated it with clay, and then he would have made poured the bronze in, and this is what you have. And even over here, he is given enough of detail to give a stand at the bottom. He's made some indentations over here. He's given a design over here, and it's hollow, so you can actually store a couple of drops of water inside. And it comes as a part of a set of about 10 or 11. This is the attention to detail that they had. And this is the kind of work that we need to celebrate. And on that same throne, here is a keychain. Yeah, this is a silver keychain. And imagine if the keychain itself was so beautiful, what the keys would have, what the box would have had, which had the key to this. This is a smaller set. I just showed you one of them. You can see all the rest. There's a little stove over here. Everything absolutely tiny, all made out of bronze with very high level of workmanship. You had chokku saman, which is not just kitchenware, but you had puja ware as well. So this is a little jasmine flower to give you a sense of scale. We saw an Abhishekha Patra, we saw a Muktali before, we saw a Basmachati, so this must have been like that. Various little kindi over here, and a bell, and a little tray for keeping puja. And of course, this is for sacred ash and for kumkum as well. You find puja articles as well in the, and even in a small one like this, he's made it so elaborate over here with little pika, with little parrots on either side. And of course, the wealthier people had some made out of silver. This is part of a set of about 200 items. And I've just shown a few over here. These are my favorites. You have an old ceiling fan, which is wired for electricity. So it actually had a little light over here as well. Here is a well with a little water pot. And just in, so that you don't have to lose the water pot, there is a little rope here as well. Diaketa, which is dice to play a game. Kuja, and a little keychain over here, a little tumbler to drink your coffee. There is a visiri to fan yourself as you're drinking your coffee. And maybe this is if you want to take a call at that time, you can enjoy your call. And just in case you can't see the light to dial a number, you have a light over here. And if you're troubled by rats, here is a rat trap. And here's a little rat inside as well. And then here, presumably, is a little spade for you to dig a hole to bury the rat. This is a part of a 200 set. I showed you some of the more whimsical ones. You would normally find these given as a gift from the boy's side to the bride in those days. And it made very appropriate sense because the bride and the boy would have been just the amount of age to play with these kind of things. And here is a little a street light as well. These are metal adornments for the hands of deities. So this would have been on the hand of a devi in a temple. Definitely not for home worship in a temple. So very beautiful. This is a solid cast work, and in the hasta. And we saw some pictures of the hasta. This would be placed on the hasta. Some of the wooden vahanas and the wooden structures in a temple would have sheet metal beaten works to them. These are some sheet metals from that kind of a collection. We don't talk much about this, but the gold and silver thread that we find in our saris and our textiles, they're also metal. I'm sure all of you have seen the finest Kanjipuram saris, and maybe many of them have them in your collection. But I wanted to show you two hats, two caps that belong to little children that I saw in an antique shop once, and I took a little photograph of that. All of this is the highest quality gold and silver thread embroidered onto the velvet of a little boy's cap. Tibetis or torches made out of, these two are made out of metal. This part would have had a very thin cotton cloth tied tightly to it, soaked in oil, and they would have been blazing fire on this, would have been used for a temple procession. This one is made out of wood. This is a cash box, is what usually dealers call, but it's actually a makeup case. If you look at the Kapchi over here, this is a very famous Chola bronze, which is in the Madras Museum. You'll find that she has a makeup case, which is exactly similar to this. And you still see these in antique shops once in a while. We're not sure of the age. They may not be Chola period. They may be much, much later. Point I wanted to underline is the shape hasn't changed at all. Pens, these are very fine works of art. You have others which are made out of ivory, and these are very functional. These are made out of iron, so this is to write, and this is to cut the palm leaf. You'll find a lot of these in old Chettiar homes. This is a Sidukavari. So you had two kinds of combs in those days. These two-part combs were used for women to straighten their knots after having a bath. And once the knots were removed with these combs, they'd have a finer tooth comb to comb their hair. And many of those metal combs would have receptacles for oil. So you open the receptacle, you put the oil, and as you're combing, the oil also spreads into your into the hair. The chewing of betel leaf is a very important custom for us. Many, many objects for that. I'm just going to show you a few here. This is a box for keeping betel leaves, a cutter for cutting them, a little box for storing the chunam, and a spittle. These are all miniatures, so I wanted to show them over here. But you have much finer examples made out of silver. In fact, as many of my aunts would tell me, many a family has lost its fortunes just because the man in the house chewed betel leaves all the time and did no work. This is a spittoon. A few more images before we close. This is a Pallanguri board, which is a game, which is usually found in wood. This is a very fancy image where you can even peel it around and there are little bells on the side. Dayakata, which are dice that you use to play. This is a lamp hook. This is, of course, a Tanjore painting, which has metal in it in the form of gold foil. This funky abstract piece of art is actually a earring. And I wanted to show this here because metal in jewelry is also important, though our topic is not about strictly about that. Weapons is an area that we've not studied at all. Some of the finest Indian Tamil Nadu weapons are in the Chennai Museum and collections abroad. Wood steel was an important, it was a very powerful steel that was made, and I believe that the process itself is lost today. Another finer example is Swami work over here. This is the finial for a walking stick. And you have a little bell on the top to jingle along as you walk. This is another Swami work plate, very grand style, which is a Lakshmi engraved in the middle. Yeah, so I think that's about it. A word of thanks to many of these people who supplied some of the images for me, and to Satyajit for taking many of the photographs as well. So I hope you've got a glance of the different range of metal objects available in Tamil Nadu and some sense of how even in the simplest objects, they showed the kind of philosophy of Bogadyam, Sukadarshana and Ramya. Thank you very much.
You know, Pradeep, I don't know how to say thank you to you. This was such a mesmerizing talk. You have received on the moderator's panel so many accolades and a lot of questions, but I didn't want to stop you at all because I actually wanted, like I think all the others, for your talk to go on forever. Because your topic was metalware of Tamil Nadu, but the journey you took us on opened up the history, the geography, the culture, the homes and the lives of the people. It has just been beyond brilliant. And I cannot wait to ask Tete and IIC, when are they bringing you back on? Because I think each section needs much more exposition, because now you have a lot of fans who are going to be following you. And so I am going to apologize to all the people who've asked you questions, because I think Tete will request them to email you directly so that you can answer them.
Actually, that's a good point, Ritu. Either on Facebook or on Instagram.
Fantastic.
Because then others will also get to know, because many of them are watching on YouTube live. So Facebook, I'm Pradeep Chakravarti. Instagram, I'm Chakravarti Pradeep. easy to Brilliant. Remember.
Because I'm going to be asking you many myself. Yes. So Good. I'm Good. Going to actually pick up the phone because I will want detailed answers from you. But Swap. Having said that, I cannot say thank you enough. This has been enlightening, mesmerizing, magnificent. Thank you, Pradeep. And thank you on behalf of all, I think more than 200 listeners. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I'm looking forward to all those questions on Facebook and Instagram. Happy to answer all of them. Thank you very much.
Fantastic. Great. Thank you, IIC. Thank you, Vaseem. Thank you, everybody.